Okay, shalom, Rastafari. Salamta. Okay, we totally spent more time than we wanted, so we're just gonna do this as quick as possible. But it's this is serious. It's spiritual warfare, and some of our potentially good brothers are being held captive, and so we're not gonna miss any important information, but we're gonna just skim through it. So now. You know, the pride goes on to make mention that Wyndham Yarwun is not. Well, first the pride mentions that Wyndham Yarwun does 10 videos on me. More than 10 videos, all on me. Me. And then that when ones are wrong and they're too accustomed to religion and that they don't want to accept that they're wrong and but what there you see the demon spirit is not presenting where is he wrong, what is the case, and so continues on to oh yeah, he makes mention that he gives Wyndham Yarwun the opportunity to prove himself. We don't prove nothing to no one except to Jah, that we, the workmen, need not be ashamed, rightfully dividing right and wrong, the word of truth. So he comes up with this idea of a debate. Like, that's what demons want. They want to learn from us, but they want to use the ignorance of the audience to allure individuals into making errors and reasoning and fallacies and logic. So they need people because they're not trying to prove anything to themselves or to the Almighty. They're trying to convince weak-minded people to follow in their bandwagon. And so he's pushing for a debate where they can prove who's right and who's wrong. So basically, he wants people to feel good. He wants to feel good amongst people, the demonic entity that's holding our potentially good brother captive. That is, so he's setting up a new. He wants to set up a neutral environment where they can discuss and debate. Basically, a fake environment. It's like they want to setting up. I mean, that's already insinuating that this is make-believe. You know, if you got something to say, put it out. You don't have to depend on people think. First of all, you're not supposed to care what people think, but earlier you made mention the spirit. We're talking about the evil spirit. Like, he doesn't even care who betrayed Christ and His Majesty, because it's all about him. Because it's that people that betrayed him. Anyways, so let us continue by. Then he gets off, like, then the spirit gets kind of. This is where the evil spirit kind of. We believe that made a mistake. It must be a rookie spirit because he got all excited and couldn't contain himself. And I'm pretty sure his false master, false idea of Satan. Is not too thrilled about what this demon did, because it got a little carried away and it started talking about kill, 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 kill. Man, so basically, he goes on to say that Wyndham Yarwun is speaking about shooting him and that because he's from Brooklyn or whatever. It's Wyndham Yarwun never said anything like that. He did present many parables insinuating if you're in the spirit of truth and faith, you would get it. But if you want to, you know, be vain in your imaginations, then I guess you could conclude anything. You could conclude that he said anything, but he never said anything about killing no one or nothing like that. And as a matter of fact, from one stating that he's more knowledgeable of the parables in a parable sense, you know, in a not so obvious sense, then for someone like that, it would have been easy to understand the parables being presented by Rasi Adonis. And if he seemed violent, well, that's because it's a weak demon that's being confronted, you see? Because we are to be violent, but our violence is not that which can be witnessed by men. You see how this demon was hurt by the parables being put out by Rasi Adonis? You know, even being crumbled and even, you know, making the demon make the mistake of getting exalted. And we'll go into how that came to be. But it's because Wendam Yadon approached this matter wisely and correctly. And the demon is all like, the demon is pretty much, it got hit hard, you know? And so that's where all this is coming from. So let us continue as far as, okay, let us continue with that, because I needed to make mention how we are to destroy these demons, and so we have every right to exercise annihilation and obliteration and, you know, genocide, if you want to call it that, of evil thoughts, and these are evil thoughts. And so even if you want to conclude in your vain imaginations that Wendam Yadon said something he never did by saying that he's going to shoot him or come after him, which is totally false, then spiritually speaking, yeah, we as Rastafari will, and it is our, not only is it like like a responsibility, it's a privilege and an honor to be able to exercise that authority and prevent that demon, in this case the demon taking the form of Tobia, from doing the same to others and holding captive other potentially good brothers. So let us continue by the, he went on rampage, he started calling Wendam Yadon out, like, yeah, so like, so what? Like, I left you a message and you didn't call back. and like, so, you know, so this is how man handle it. So what's up? Like, call, you know, straight up, like, exalt. I mean, well, yelling and being aggressive. And this is the demon showing his weakness, to be honest. And so he kind of slipped right there. But yeah, so he gets all excited and starts yelling and saying, like, yeah, I'm a man, and this is how we do, and this is, you know, all that gangster rap talk. So, which is nonsense, really. But, goes on to say that he left a message, then left another one, and that it's been a month, that he's been sitting on this for a month, something that is so-called so insignificant that he refuses to make mention the name to whom he is addressing this issue. So insignificant that he sits on it for a month. So he's captive. He did not move forward to where mobility could not be obscured or prevented or obstructed better. So he's in a frozen psychological state of mind. He is captive of these demonic forces, more specifically pride. So for the last month, he's been sitting on this demonic prison of pride. And I don't even need to say more to show how real the incarceration is. So he starts blaspheming that everything that Wendam Yadon says is fraud, and that Wendam Yadon is a part of the bigger problem, whatever that is, and that all of a sudden he brings in Ethiopia, the land of churches, and that the civilization, the only civilization since the beginning of time that has survived to prosper, is Ethiopia because of their faith in spirituality. I don't know if Ethiopia is the first civilization to survive since the beginning. I know that Geta Jesus Christus is the only foundation that exists since the beginning that will always be triumphant. As far as civilization, I don't know. And as far as Ethiopia, if you mean I and I, the body of Christ, the good land, then I guess spiritually, parabolically, yes. But if you mean the physical, I don't know. I really don't know what to say as far as that. The land of churches. There's only one church in Christ Jesus, and that is I and I, Rastafari. And so I don't know what that means, but because he calls Wyndham Yaddo out and says, like, if you claim to be from Ethiopia, well, I claim to be from Ethiopia, born and raised, and still being raised, you know, born in the spirit in that high place in Zion, and being raised, being established and erected and straightened out and being corrected in and through Getai Jesus Christus. And yep, we are to become that perfection, that good land. Gold tried by fire, we could even say. So I do claim to be from Ethiopia, but I can't speak for Wyndham Yaddo. But that was the whole reason this was brought up. Now, if we go to Matthew chapter 16, it's the first, as far as the book of Matthew. I mean, yeah, the book of Matthew, it's the first place where church is mentioned. Chapter 16, verse 18. And it says, and this is funny because not funny, this is just what it is, but it's right after the verse we used to prove how thoughts are not necessarily man-made, or, you know, that man does not come up with these thoughts, that some are influenced by good and some by bad, or just don't exist. Some are good and the rest don't exist, but so... Verse 18, and I say also to thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. I will build my gathering of people. Better would be better said. So ecclesiasta. I can't pronounce that all that well. Ecclesiasta. Whatever, I think I spelled it wrong. Excuse that. This is talking about the called, the election, the called out ones, the gathering of the body in Christ. And so, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So this is the first mention in the book of Matthew as far as churches. And right after that, it's like, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Basically, so to give ones an idea, so Ethiopia, the land of churches, and what's going on, I just made that connection. It's not the best one, but as far as what Matthew says, or Getai Jesus says in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, yeah, it's definitely a very strong connection. So when this word hell, it's talking about the spirit world, whether it be bound or unbound, low, high, you know, it's talking about everything in the spirit world. And so that shall not stand against I and I. But we just wanted to show how it made mention how when it's talking about I and I, Rastafari, the body of Christ, no evil spirit, whether, because Jesus Christus has authority above everything like that. Everything is under the authority of I and I, Geta Christus. So let us continue. I'll be honest, we kind of lost touch on why we included that. There was something deeper than what we actually presented, but nonetheless, let us continue. So it goes on to mention that he has faith, that he knows that the Rastafari mansions can all come together as one with one doctrine, because people are followers. That's what he says. See, we don't want different mansions to come together. Yeah, there's different mansions, but I personally will dwell in my humble sukkot until we establish Beta Israel, the house of God, the house of prayer, not mansions and stuff like that. I mean, sure, we would really enjoy to have the company of all Rastafari, but what is Rastafari? So then that don't do the will of Rastafari, they may see this is an error in judging by appearance. So some of these mansions, yeah, they could be so-called Rastafari, but that if they don't do the will of the father Rastafari, the head to be revered, then maybe they're not Rastafari, and they don't, and we don't want them. So basically, that's going to sound hard and harsh, whatever, but I stand strong in that opinion. I mean, we don't need who we don't need. So if they're doing their own thing, maybe either we failed in not having presented the opportunity to them, or they weren't called. Simple as that. Then he goes on to say that Jesus Christos is, that's why he's the good shepherd, because people are followers. And he said that, the demon spirit in the form of Tobia, that is. So no, that's not why Geta Jesus is a good shepherd. He's a good shepherd because he giveth his life for his sheep. And it doesn't mean that, even if people are considered sheep, it doesn't mean that everyone are his sheep. He's got certain sheep. As a matter of fact, his sheep are spotless. Ever since Genesis, we can, the whole situation with Laban and how we believe it was, you're gonna have to go to that to reference it. And I'm not too familiar with it, but it is hold on. It is. We believe it's Jacob. And so Jacob and the whole deal with the whole situation with Laban, how so watch, let's read this. So it's Genesis chapter 30, and we're gonna go to verse 29. And he said to him, "Thou knowest how I have served thee, and how thy cattle was with me." So this is Jacob addressing Laban. And continuing, "For it was little which thou hadst before I came, and it is now increased to a multitude, and the Lord hath blessed thee since my coming. And now, when shall I provide for mine own house also?" Give thanks, Most High. This is really good. So, and he said, "What shall I give thee?" And Jacob said, "Thou shalt not give me anything." We don't take a gift, you know, because that corrupted the word. "If thou wilt do this thing for me, I will again feed and keep my flock. I will pass through all thy flock today, removing from thence all the speckled and spotted cattle, and all the brown cattle among the sheep, and the spotted and speckled among the goats, and of such shall be my hire." We'll get into how why this is kind of like funny, but "So shall my righteousness answer for me in time to come, when it shall come for my hire before thy face. Every one that is not speckled and spotted among the goats, and brown among the sheep, that shall be counted stolen with me." And Laban said, "Behold, I would it might be according to thy word." And he removed the day the goats ring spotted and speckled, and it had white in it and brown among the sheep. So basically, this is we were trying to mention how certain sheep are getas, and we are spotless. But it's interesting that scripture was interesting, not only because it kind of goes into a little bit of detail as far as the dreadlocks, because you see the ones that are the sheep that were of the gutter, that were once filthy but now clean, are the whole gutter is it has to do with knots and twisting and dreadlocks and having locks on the hair, because in the gutter that means that they were in the mud and in filthy conditions, and so their woolly hair would get all tangled up, and so that kind of goes into the whole dreadlocks, and you know, most of I and I have in a sense or another, some in worse cases, others in not so bad cases, but we've all in a sense have come from Galilee or from the gutters, and so also. But it was interesting how, you know, brown actually means black in at least in the Bible, in the King James Version, it's when, if you look up brown, it's referring to black. And so basically, it's saying that all of his sheep will be spotless. It won't be no color, right? And it's not to have outsiders come and say, see, color doesn't matter. Well, then accept the truth, we say to you. So, and it's higher, and yeah, it's because it's higher, it's kind of like Issachar in a sense. And I mean, not to get into all of that, right? But yeah, let us continue. And so that is why Gittes is a good shepherd, because he giveth his life for his sheep. But his sheep know his voice and they come to him. So we are to be able to discern from good and bad thoughts. And you know, in Mexican culture, you would say, or I don't even know where this comes from, but I know an aunt, or and the family, like they say this to little kids. Whenever you can't go to sleep, they tell you to count sheep. So they say borreguitos or whatever, un borreguito, 200, and so you're supposed to count to 100. And that has nothing to do, but it kind of does. You see, we're all the thoughts of Gietayesus, and if one thought goes astray, then Gietayesus has to go put it in order, you know, because we are his letters from A to Z, from Alpha to Omega, from Ha to Pe, from Aleph to Tau. And so basically that's kind of like putting that into context as far as the whole sheep and all of that. But to clarify that he's not a good shepherd because people are followers. As a matter of fact, people follow the wickedness because they're not of Jesus Christos. So whatever. So yeah, I'm kind of done with this. I really don't want to continue with that. We want to go to, honestly, I mean, oof. Yeah, we should have done this a while back. You know, we apologize if we bored anyone, but really, but it is necessary to understand. I'm sure some of these details can assist on ones in future combats, you know, in the spiritual warfare. So now, let us introduce John, Johannes Wangel, chapter 7. Okay, it's kind of long, so let us pause right here and let's do the last part on that.